best boxing podcast in the world.
Are you ready? No, I said, are you ready?
Instructions from the dressing room. Do you have any questions?
I got a question. You got any excuses tonight, Roy?
Let's not ask questions like that. Let's touch gloves and go to work.
Tonight, Roy.
Let's go to work.
I wish I was 50 years younger and I'd kick your ass.
Come on, dude.
You don't know shit about boxing.
What's going on, everybody? Another episode of Cheesy's Box Show. Angelo here with my boy JP. JP, what's up, man?
Like you said, ain't shit going on in boxing.
Nah, there ain't shit going on. First things first, follow us on Twitter, Cheap Seats Box, iTunes, and Stitcher, rate, review, and subscribe. You can be an excellent official sponsor. Yeah, that's 2 weeks in a row, guys. I got to be honest, I'm a little disappointed in you guys.
We still love you.
But not as much as we did a few weeks ago. You guys can email the show, CheapSeatsBox@yahoo.com. You guys can check out the merchandise, Cafe Press, if you guys want to pick up anything. So let's get into it. Huge week of fights that didn't happen. You started off with the Thurman Porter. That was supposed to be this weekend. We know that wasn't happening. Zab Judah card gets wiped out. Rigo can't get his visa straight. He didn't fight on the Flanagan Matthews card. And then Lemieux can't make weight. And James De La Rosa says, you know what? That's all right. I don't want to fight. If you ain't going to make the weight, I ain't fighting. And you know what? Fuck it. The only thing I say is, like, he should still get paid because he made weight. That's yes. There needs to start to be some kind of penalty for not doing this shit. You know, that's your job. This is what you get paid for. You get paid to make weight and get in that ring. When you don't make weight, you ain't doing half your job.
Half? It's going to come to a point where I got to give De La Rosa credit for that. Like, whatever, dude. You ain't make weight, no. We're not going to. Because truth be told, if they still fought and De La Rosa lost, and he felt somewhere because he was outweighed, and it was too, you know, it was too much of an issue, the loss will still count.
Yeah.
So, if you can do that and still win and get paid, what really, you know, because truth be told, when people say they have the clause that you lose a certain amount of money, yeah, but you're not actually paying for that night. You're paying because if you beat the fighter, you take money out of their pocket the next time.
Mm-hmm.
So, sometimes you got to cut that snake off at the head.
I guess this last weekend, really, Terry Flanagan beat Derry Matthews, which I said was going to happen. I wouldn't say it was overly boring as much as it was uneventful. You know, there's a little bit difference. Like, it didn't put you to sleep, but it was also like it was hard to keep your attention as well. You know what I mean? Flanagan dominates the fight. Derry Matthews is Derry Matthews. There's a reason he had nine losses going into the fight, and they kept on making it seem like, you know, he was just trying to weather the early storm before he pulls out that win. You know, they were just trying to sell the fight.
That was a big, long, deep breath.
And you know what, though? That's what we're starting to get out all these fights. Even the UK fights. You know, this goes right in line with Frampton and Quigg, and it goes in line with Lee and Saunders.
Well, at least Frampton and Quigg, you saw the fighting spirit. It was just in two different halves of the fight.
But it was a lot of shit talking for the action didn't back up the shit talking.
Right, right. What do you want to say? I mean,
there ain't nothing to say.
Let's just see who Flanagan fights next, and let's just see. I mean, he makes weight. I don't know how. He makes weight. Let's just see who's willing to fight him, who's able to fight him, because he needs better opposition. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, he's in one of those situations where he's beating the people that he should beat. So with that, there is no challenge. So, you know, how good can you be if you're always beating people you should beat? You know?
The big news this week. This is how light the... Because there ain't shit on. Look, this week, look. I get, you know what? If you're going to look at any fight this weekend, and I'm not even being biased because we're based over here, just outside of Houston, that the Juan Diaz card on Unimas. And they're actually doing some pretty good promo. I've been seeing it on Twitter and stuff. Big George is out there promoting it because his son is doing some of the promotion on the show. I think his name is George. I think
George or George? Or George?
I think it was George.
Okay.
One of them. But the reason I would say that, if there's going to be a fight that you pay attention to, I think it's that one, to see how he looks coming off the rotator cuff surgery, because of the rumors that he'd be fighting Felix Verdejo in June. So I guess if there's anything you're going to watch, it's that, because you know they're talking about a step-up fight for Verdejo. Juan Diaz's name keeps on coming up, keeps on coming up. And before he got hurt, his name was coming up for Crawford. Remember when Crawford was looking for those step-up fights? Before he moved up to 140, that was one of the names that they started tossing around. So I guess if there's anything you're going to watch, I guess you can watch that. I don't know what you're going to see. You're not going to see much of a competition in the fight, but you're going to, I guess, look to see how rusty he looked, or if the shoulder hung in there. You know, the typical questions.
I hate to say this, but I hope he wins, but doesn't look too impressive. Because the way boxing is going, if he looks too impressive, then that fight might not happen. You gotta give him a little wiggle room, like, oh, he might not be ready just yet. And then Juan could come in at tip-top condition the next fight, and it'll be a real fight. But if he come in too impressive, he might, you know what? I don't think he's just a big enough name at the particular time. We have these other political issues. I don't think his visa will work in the United States, even though he's a citizen. It doesn't really matter. You know, this, it sucks. But great fight for both if they make it.
Yeah, because you get to see where Verdejo is, and you know a guy like Diaz can pull from his experience. And if the kid ain't ready or he is overhyped, he'll show it. He'll expose it.
And on the flip side, if Diaz wins, automatic title contention talk. Because you can't, because they're putting Verdejo on that fast track anyways. Mm-hmm. So if you beat him, somebody that's higher up above him has to fight you. So that's why it's an interesting fight. Both fighters have something to gain and something to lose. So I like it.
And I guess if you're going to look for the one thing, that the big announcement this week was the Showtime schedule. Showtime pulled out their, I guess you would call it their spring schedule through the beginning of summer. It's a good list. It got really hyped up because, you know, when I looked on Twitter, it was like, man, wow, Showtime pulling out the big guns. The Showtime schedule is pretty nice. It's nice. But there's probably only one surprise in there. Was like, ooh, I like that. You know, the fact that they got Provodnikov and Molina. But just Provodnikov going over there, because I think there's better fights for Provodnikov on that side than there was on the HBO side. I mean, him and Broner would be good. Him and Porter would be good. Him and Thurman would be good. Those guys who don't utilize the movement as much line up to have the better fights. Even him and Algieri having a rematch
would be a good fight.
I don't think him and Spence would be a good fight. I don't think it's a good matchup for him. But,
well, you never know, because can Spence take that initial first shot?
Yeah, that's true, because he ain't going to get tested from Algieri. So.
Yeah, so that'll be the interesting part about that.
But just dissecting the Showtime schedule, and I will say, you give it the credit it's due as far as you compare their schedule to the HBO, what's on HBO itself, not the pay-per-view parts right. of it. The HBO schedule, it's superior to HBO schedule. But there weren't a lot of surprises. You know, they threw on their Martin versus Joshua. Well, we knew that was going to be on there. We knew right. that fight was coming. We already knew what date it was. We knew that fight was coming to Showtime. It's not a big shock. Lee Selby's on the undercard because it's in the UK. Not a big shock. So, yeah, good fight, but it wasn't like a blockbuster. Ooh, I didn't see that one coming. We knew that was coming. And then the Wilder-Povetkin card, we're looking at May 21st. Well, we knew that was going to be on Showtime. So that's not a shocker. And those are probably their best fights on Showtime.
Win, win. Win, win, win. Mm-hmm. Win. Win for the fans. Because these are at least intriguing fights just by looking at them. Win for the boxers. Because they're on, I guess, premium channels. Win for actually Al Heyman and them, because you can save a little bit of money because you ain't got to buy this time.
No, you're actually getting fees for this time.
Right. So, and also a win for future fights, because if you can make these fights and get people interested in these fights, you can also get people interested in which way to go when these chips fall. You know, so I think it's a great situation. We just got to hope, you know, everybody sees it through. At this point, you know how I am about it. I'm like, I hear the fights happening, but until I see the first round and the bell go off, you know, it's too much of this, too many shenanigans. But it's a great, I think it's a great opportunity, not for the, including the people involved, but more so, okay, now, if you're going to start this down this road, let's see what's up. You got to have a follow-up to this, you know. So it's a precursor to at least something hopefully better happening later on in the year.
So those fights were ones we knew about except for the Provodnikov thing. We knew the Provodnikov thing was, that's big.
Right.
Just hearing that, I was like, okay, that's cool because that's right. a new piece. The first one was Martin Joshua. That was April 9th. April, the next week, Gary Russell Jr. is fighting and Jose Pedraza are fighting. But their title defenses leave a lot to be desired, you know. Patrick Hyland for Russell Jr., who, when was the last time we actually,
he won the belt.
This is his first title defense. He won that belt a long time ago.
Yeah.
Pedraza, he's had a defense, I think, against Stephen Smith. I think it's one of the thousand Smiths out of England.
But
I would rather see Russell in there against
a few other people.
But Santa Cruz. They're talking about finishing that one. That's the one that really excites me, is the Santa Cruz Frampton fight. If they get it done for June, which it looks like they're going to. But you never know. Like you said, until they get in the ring. And until they sign that shit. Signing this shit is like only 25% of the way. Exactly. making the weight is the other half. Right. Is half. And then getting in the ring is the last 25%.
And unfortunately, that's how it's going. But you got that mixed with the Canelo. I just forgot the doggone fight. The Walters, Lomachenko. So it's like you have this little stretch where, you know, Showtime has got the bulk of it, but HBO and pay-per-view, they got theirs in there. It's like this is productive. Mm-hmm. This is the type of boxing that boxing fans want. You know, you can actually sit back and say, you know what? Yeah, I can go home and I can watch this tonight. Oh, yeah, I'm excited to see that fight. When they promote that fight, they don't need to do too much, but I want them to promote that fight. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So this is what we need. Because unfortunately, if we don't get stuff like this, what do we have? Yeah, I'm starting to sound like a damn politician.
They skip a week, and then you go into April 30th, Badu Jack versus Lucian Bute after Chavez Jr. pulls out with hurt heels. It was funny because, you know, when you hear Chavez Jr. and his heels, something wrong with his heels, you go back to thinking about him walking around in pink underwear. And the heels, you got to specify now. Do you have a problem with the heels that he was wearing or his heels in his feet? But Chavez Jr. is a joke. But the Jack Boutte fight, nah. And then James DeGale against Rogelio Medina. If those two guys were fighting Jack and DeGale,
I think they put him on a crash course.
Hopefully. Yeah. DeGale, Medina is the best fight as far as nicknames because it's Chunky and Porky. So.
Well, Porky and Chunky.
Yeah. It's great names. Not a great fight. They kind of cheated, I think, a little bit with the Thurman Porter, adding that to the Showtime because it's Showtime Championship Boxing on CBS, sponsored by something like that. It's the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. Let's just try to throw it all. Yeah. I'm kind of curious. If it's Showtime Championship Boxing, but it's on CBS, how did that work? Did Al get Showtime? Hold on. But here's the thing. How did he get Showtime to pay the licensing fee for CBS, which CBS owns Showtime? I don't understand how that all works.
Okay. For years, you used to watch the Jets play in New Jersey. The Giants play in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. But they were the New York Giants and New York Jets playing in New Jersey. So, this is just boxing in New Jersey. That's pretty much. You know, there's no bones about it. You know, I can't remember the. I'm trying to think of the town. It's another sports team that's just like that.
Well, I mean, you got the Cowboys don't play in Dallas. They haven't played in Dallas.
And I hate the Cowboys. I didn't want to use them as a reference.
The Rangers also.
They don't play in Dallas. They play in Texas. See, that's why they were slick with that one. They were slick with that
one. The Niners don't play in San Francisco. They play in Santa Clara now. You know what? I was talking to my son about these. I was going through these lists of teams that don't play
where they live,
where they're from.
It's a lot of them.
Well, the Pistons the Pistons used to play in Auburn Hills.
Right. I think they still
are. Are they still in Auburn Hills? They're the Pistons. I don't care. But that's kind of what they went to with the Showtime Championship Boxing of CBS.
The Baltimore PBC. Ravens, I think that's Owens Mills. I think it's Owens Mills because they don't want to play in Baltimore.
Well, you go also where the property is the cheapest, too.
No, Owens Mills would not.
No, okay.
Owens Mills, no. That's not cheap.
And then they announced also, you know, the Fox hosting Ortiz Berto 2. But that's not on Showtime. But
still a good fight.
There's five cards there. Three of them. Okay, here's the thing. I'm going to get, because I don't have Showtime. I told you to cancel my thing. And I'm really not overly like, well, I need to get my subscription back because I want to get the Martin Joshua because that's going to be
interesting
on Box Nation. I can get that on the stick. So is Wilder Povetkin. That's also going to be on one of those
foreign stations.
Yeah. So I'm going to, you know, I'm going to have to watch the Russell, Jack Boutte, and the Provodnikov fight on some kind of delay. And then on Fox, you're going to get that fight. And the Ortiz and Berto, and then you're going to get CBS fight. You're going to watch it anyway with Thurman Porter.
I mean, maybe I should just say it like you said. Ring TV has an app, right? So maybe Ring TV, Golden Boy, Top Rank, PBC, and I guess Don King, he might have to merge with somebody. You know, Eddie Hearn. Who else am I missing? I know the wonderful lady.
Oh, Kathy Duva.
They need to decide, you know what, let's get some apps.
Yeah. Well, Golden Boy is next. They got that Golden Boy TV coming out.
Right.
So they're next. I guess they're first because they got the Ring TV Live. That's his anyway.
Right. So just get some apps. Because, truth be told, you know, you got to think in the future. Not the present. You know, boxing has its base just like every other sport, but we talked about this before. Every other sport has their own app. I'm sure golf probably has an app, and I don't even, I don't give a damn about golf, you know, but get your own app. That's all you got to do, and you will have lots and lots of people. Get your advertising money that way. It's a new, there you go. Another one of our great ideas that y'all still owe us for because we gave it a lot.
But we haven't done that in forever. Yeah, yeah, I forgot about that one.
But
wow, a segment long forgotten.
At the end of the day, we going to see these fights. You know, I'm going to see them all. But, you know, I'm glad y'all technically made them because they're technical to me until I see them.
Yeah.
You know. But as going back a little bit, as far as Jack and Chavez, gotta appreciate Lucien Bouté for taking the fight, you know, with the circumstances. I ain't got nothing to say to Chavez Jr. really, cause you know,
ain't nothing to say.
Cause you may not know, y'all may not know this, but I sent Angelo a video a while back. I want to say from Ellie Seckback, like ESN. And I was laughing. I'm like, he looks like he quit already. Like, he would just sit at a table like, yeah. I was like, oh, Lord. I don't think he's ready right now. And this just is ridiculous. Got to give props to Badu Jack because that's kind of a good fight, at least name-wise, because he's not trying to. This is the thing about that. Even with Badu Jack stands, maybe it's Badu Jack TMT, I don't care. But it's probably, you know, just what he's doing, he's actually fighting people that make him, he has threats. He's not fighting just a pushover. Like, he's actually probably had better title defenses in the last 2-3 fights than a lot of the people who've made title defenses in the last 2-3 fights. So, I mean, this is.
I want to say this, too. Floyd needs to be taking a task for that shit, too, because if there's one fighter in and around him that has kind of changed people's perspective on him, it's Badu Jack.
Right.
He's, after getting iced in, what was it, one round, mm-hmm. right? He come back and he has good wins, gets a title, and he wants to fight. He's going to fight Chavez Jr., who you'd be lucky if he made weight. He wants to fight DeGale. He's fighting Bouté. But you don't hear Floyd pushing him. He pushes
people
Theophane. And he even pushed Broner, who wasn't even under his wing. And he's pushing. We just talked about him. He's fighting Algeria. Why can't I think of his name?
Oh, Spence.
He pushed Errol Spence, who's not even part of his team. Yeah, he's pushing these guys, yet he's got a guy on his banner that he's not pushing who actually deserves to be pushed because he actually earned it, unlike the other people. He earned it. And I
think it's a two-sided coin because I think you're absolutely right. Like, Badu Jack deserves to be. Like, yo, this guy, he got up off the mat and became a champion. Mm-hmm. That's you got to give him. That
and I shitted on Jack forever.
Yeah. I mean, I think Mickey Bay did the same thing. But I think he lost the belt too. Because he wound up winning after that.
Yeah, that's right.
So they're both kind of in the same boat, you know.
But Jack really
he's top on that list.
Yes, yeah.
He's definitely top on that list. The other thing is, it might be a good thing for Jack, because if you don't hear his name, you don't see him coming, and he keeps coming, you know. So he may like being under the radar. It might be a nice little wonderful instigation. Like, you know what, you ain't gonna talk about me. I'm gonna knock somebody out, and you gonna talk about me tomorrow. So I like it, but you're right. I mean, Jaylion Love gets more of a push than Badu Jack. That's, you know, I'm not going to stay a fan of Javante. He's pushing Javante right now, you know. And you got to push your fighters, but, you know, that's why it's like, you should push him because Badu Jack is kind of like a flagship fighter. He's an underdog, you know. But at the same time, it's like, well, if I push him, I don't want to put all the extra pressure on him. And because that's a different type of boxing at that point. You got to maintain this and maintain that and do this and do that. And he might not want people to do that. Maybe, maybe not. Who knows?
I guess we went through kind of the list of the Showtime fights. There's some other things that just kind of broke out. The rumor fight, even though J-Rock just got put into the mandatory position, Jermall Charlo gonna defend his title against Austin Trout.
Because they've been talking back and forth.
J-Rock called out both of those guys, and they... Mm-hmm. Let's not fight him. Let's fight each other. Despite him, you know. I think it's... Trout, he just hasn't been the same since the Canelo fight, for whatever reason. It's not like Canelo like put a beating on him or anything, but he hasn't been the same since.
Just confidence.
Yeah. But could be a very dangerous fight for Charlo. Experience, he's been in there with good fighters. I wouldn't say great fighters, but really good fighters.
Yeah.
He has the experience. So, and I don't think Jermall's going to go ice him in, you know, 2-3 rounds. He's going to have to work for it. And if Trout can get into a rhythm, he'll be trouble for Jermall. And then Trout's going to end up having to fight Williams, which he didn't want to do anyway. So, I don't know. But it was just, that one's just breaking. It's a rumored fight that they're going to put it on Fox, on the undercard of Ortiz Berto 2, which is a good spot for it, because it puts a spotlight on Charlo.
Yeah.
Because say what you will about the diminished state of Ortiz and Berto, because they both are diminished. But it's going to be a good fight. And people are actually interested in it because the first one was good. So,
and I'm going to say something about both of them. For y'all people who might, you got to remember something. Yes, Ortiz is a quitter, but that was the one fight he didn't quit in. So he might not actually quit this fight. This is why it makes it interesting, because he could look back. It's getting rough. Last time I ain't quit and I won, though. Yeah. So, you know, so he might actually show up and get hit and say, I could do this. And both of them was on the mat, you know, so that's what makes it interesting. With Trout and Charlo, you know, classic boxer versus puncher. But at the same time, I always say this, I started saying this after, I think, not the Canelo fight, but the fight after. I forgot who that was. That Trout needs to change his punch selection.
Is that?
Because he was just like Darijan, he's like a 1-2 fighter. He might do a couple of ones first and then a two, but it was always just straight shots. I was like, if he changes punch selection, he actually throws people for a loop, because now they know the jab is coming. They know the double jab is coming. They maybe even a triple, maybe, you know, a double and one over the top, but they know what's coming.
And let's not forget, Trout did school Cotto.
Yeah.
He's got skills.
Yeah.
And if you scored the fight legitimately, I scored the fight against Canelo for Trout, because you had to score the whole fight. I understand why people... If he was to score the fight after 8 rounds, I had Canelo up. But Trout finished stronger to me, because at that point it seemed like Canelo took his foot off the gas, because the damn open scoring had up 8 rounds of nothing.
he was up at the beginning. So, you in here, baby. But Charlo he's interesting, because this is a fight that he could lose his cool in, which is not a bad thing for him, because that means he's gonna try to knock your head off. But at the same time, sometimes you have to be patient, and he was patient in his last few fights. Like, okay, I'm gonna get you, just not right now.
You know? He systematically broke down.
Yeah,
canine fast. If I was Julian Williams, this is gonna be on Fox. I rush the ring. I rush the ring because doing it on Twitter don't get it done sometimes. You got a national audience. Why not? At least you put him to the test where, like, if he says, yeah, we're going to do it next, ain't no backing out now unless you want to just be made fun of or talk bad about. But you were saying something about Quitter in there with Ortiz. And I was going to say the fact that, was it Matisse got pulled off the, what card was that?
Oh.
Is it Canelo fight?
Or, it might have been.
Anyway, the fight against Herrera, right?
Right.
Because his eye still is not healed up. The word is he may not fight ever again. When I said I lost a lot of respect for him when he kind of quit, I got to pull that shit back and say, I was wrong. Yeah, I mean, he felt it obviously right when it happened. And let's be honest, that started the fight before that, or not the fight before that, but, you know, a few fights before that against Garcia, where he started, where the eye swelled up. You think about it, that's probably where a lot of this started. And because he was winning that fight clearly to the eye. And then I think a lot of people scored that eye more than they scored the fight. But he may not fight now. So
you know what? I'm still
a fan. The eye is a funny thing, man.
Yeah, I'm still a fan. It hurt my heart that he lost the post. I ain't gonna lie. I'm still bitter about that. But at the same time, if this is it, he had a good career. And I hope he did right financially. And I'm gonna miss him. But at the same time, you know what? Health over coming back in the ring. If you can't fight no more, don't do it.
I say him and Margarito fight in a one eye closed. I can beat you with one eye closed.
A patch match?
Yeah, yeah. I could beat you with one arm tied behind my back. Well, I could beat you with one eye closed. Too far?
Yeah, man. That's cold, man. That's cold. It'll happen, though. It'll happen. Because I know Margarito will be down. Okay. I'm ready. I'm in shape.
I'll wear the patch. I don't care. You were talking about Postal, him and Crawford rumored to be fighting in June on pay-per-view. Big mistake. If it's pay-per-view, that's a huge mistake.
You know what? Depending on if they got somebody actually on the main event, that's you know what
that I'm is the main event. That is the pay-per-view. If Triple G had trouble, you're definitely gonna have trouble because I would say that the boxing public is far more behind Triple G than they are Crawford. And Triple G had trouble with it. And that was with a fight that people were excited about. So,
but here's the thing. You gotta start somewhere. You know, I don't like it because if it's gonna be your first pay per view, try to stack the card. Because if you stack the card on pay per view, then you're not so much the pressure is not so much on you. You know, people just like you talk about used to talk about Don King. A lot of those fights, even the Tyson's fights or the Chavez fights, the card was stacked.
Oh, he always stacked the card.
Right. So, stack the card. That way it's like, oh, okay.
Well, plus it's going to be tough to sell because even if you beat Postal, it's going to be hard to look good against Postal.
Right. So, put other fighters in. You know what? If I was them, if it too bad, too late, you can't do it now. I'm like, you know what? Can we get this Walters Lomachenko on this card with us pay-per-view? That might bring home Vargas and
Salido.
Yeah, you know, just stack the card, have people go, you know what, I might not want to watch you, but 3-4 of y'all going at it, you know, I could do that.
I'm trying to think of one of the things I saw was Paul Williams back in the game as a trainer now.
Oh, that's
so that's good.
I love it.
I forget what the fighter's name is. He's fighting on the opening bout on the Showbox card next Friday. Whatever, next Friday or Saturday. It's probably Friday that the Showbox card is on. He's on the opening bout. His guy is the B-side in that fight. I just read it. But anyway, he's getting back in the game. That's good to hear, man. I mean,
yeah. Tell you something, man.
He won't be jumping in the ring to in between rounds.
That's all right. All you gotta do is listen.
No, but you know what? Not even trying to be a dick about it. Like, that's just kind of interesting. Like, so he's going to be the trainer. I wonder what if he's going to have any role as far as a corner man and how they're going to work that, you know, because...
Easily.
Because it's... Where is he going to position himself? Because usually there's tables by there and the steps.
See...
They're probably just... I guess they're going to accommodate for it.
Yeah.
You know? So, yeah.
I mean, you're not going to accommodate for Paul? Like, seriously?
No, I'm saying... No, they should. They absolutely should. I'm just saying... It's at a small casino in Oklahoma, so you kind of, are they going to have all that in play to do it, you know?
Yeah. They should.
I'm just saying, like, I'm just wondering, because obviously he's going to be, his instructions would be from the outside, obviously, but you kind of figure, like, where, but I think it's just, the fact that I saw that kind of made me smile just seeing it, because there's so little, like, really good news in boxing, like, that was something that was...
I like it for multiple reasons because, for one, it's Paul Williams. For two, ironically enough, you know, people forget that some people can't walk anymore or have certain handicaps. Just like Freddie Roach. He has a handicap technically, but he's a good-ass trainer with a handicap. You know what I'm saying? So for people who have disabilities, it's like, you know, it's one of those things that, oh, yeah, I can do that. Yeah, mm-hmm. You can. If you got the mind for it, you got the mentality for it, do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it helps because, people look, they're going to accommodate them just because, you know, even if they were assholes, they don't want to look like assholes. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like, but I think that's great because Paul Williams is...
I don't know how he's going to teach him his greatest strength.
You can't teach that.
You can't be eight feet tall in the welterweight division.
Yeah, you can't teach that,
so I don't...
But he always says you got to be willing to take that shot and keep coming.
He always was. I mean,
right. So
Paul Williams wasn't in bad fights.
Right. So it's like, look, you know, his fighter's gonna have to have the mentality at least of, look, you got to come with it. Like, you win and you lose and you got to come with it. And you know, stepping off the gas, you got to come with it. If they gonna beat you, they gonna have to beat you.
Mm-hmm.
So, and if you have to win, you gonna have to take it. So it's. That's a win-win for boxing because the way that I look at it now, you got people, Paul Williams' mentality is you need some people with that old school type of training, the old school mentality. Like the day we may lose like Freddie Roach or Buddy McGirt or, you know, David Lee Jackson, like... When you lose these people...
John David Jackson.
John David. I'm sorry. I'm thinking about something else at the time.
I know who you're talking about.
Trust me, as many mistakes
as I've been making, man, I'm like...
You know, these trainers, even like Raja, they have an old school bank to go to. Mm. And a lot of new trainers have a lot of too much new stuff going on that gets away from the fundamentals. So, just having that blood in the ring is like, yeah. Because that mentality is going to beat people alone. And I can't wait to see how it pans out. And hopefully, that is not going to be his only fight. I know he got plenty more coming because, you know, Paul is cool, man.
Yeah. I was going to say, one last thing I saw was an interview with Keith Thurman talking about, you know, there's still kind of questions about the accident and everything. But when he was asked about catch weights, and he was talking about the fans shouldn't worry about that stuff. Why should they even care? You know, catch weight. The old school catch weights has been around forever. You know, catch weights used to mean something. To me, super middleweight is a catch weight. Those are the old catch weights when the middleweight champ and the light heavyweight champ want to fight each other. They would meet somewhere super middleweight thing. That's why people have a problem with them because of using them as crutches. And as fans, actually, because, you know, I love when boxers or any athlete says, well, the fans shouldn't worry about that stuff. Well, actually, The fans can worry about whatever they want to worry about, because if it isn't for the fans, then there is no sport. If there's nobody buying the tickets, buying the pay-per-views, then there is no sport. So the fans, and it's not like the fans are like, it's not like we're, you know, like doing something like out of the ordinary, like we're over the top with it. Like, why should we even care about that stuff? Like, sometimes it's legit stuff that fans care about. It's just that the new mentality of the boxer is, what we want to do.
My take is consistent and off the wall sometimes. I got a problem with the sanctioning bodies for that, for allowing this to go on so many times. That's first. But when it comes to the fighters and fans together, and I'm gonna use a scenario, and I know you're gonna go in after this one because you told me about this last week. When it comes to Con Canelo, the reason the catchweights are a problem is because when you make fights look good on paper and people pay for them, and then they see how it looks one-sided the minute they turn on the fight, mm-hmm. like something don't add up about this fight, and then after the fight's over, it's like, yeah, I fell for the hype of the names, I fell for the hype of the promotion and propaganda, and now I'm looking at it, and I'm like, man, y'all set me up to just, you know, maybe the next time I see a catchweight, I don't want to watch that fight. Maybe the next fighter I see that I know shouldn't be fighting at that weight, fight somebody smaller, I'm not going to watch that fight. Maybe I'm not, it kills the participation of the fans, because fans are smartening up to, okay, so if you 155, but you really 175, and if you 155 and you really 155, okay, now how is this going to work in a ring for real? Like, how fair of a fight is this? And then you're like, this person, the small person, can't really hurt the big person, because the small person doesn't punch like Mike Tyson or something, you know? So it's like, huh, why am I going to, you know, what am I going to do with this? I mean, and unfortunately, and I'm going to use this example, that's part of Triple G's problem until he fought Lemieux. He was fighting guys that didn't necessarily have power. But Lemieux fought a guy with power. He just fought him in a different way, so it made him look all the more better. So the catchweight is a bit of a setup for everybody. Like, trust me, nobody wants to watch, let's see how I can put this. Nobody wants to watch the Carolina Panthers or Denver Broncos. Matter of fact, forget that. Nobody wants to watch the Golden State Warriors play the Milwaukee Bucks every night. Mm-hmm. Or the Sacramento Kings. It's a setup.
I always laughed at that. You know, people always talked about that with Triple G. They never fought a puncher. He fought punchers. He just didn't fight the punchers that they wanted him to fight. Right. Like I said, didn't Rubio knock out Lemieux?
But that's
the argument that's always put out there. Right, and if it's said enough, you start to go, no, he ain't fought no punchers. Ruby had like 51 knockouts. And it's like 65 wins. Yeah. Curtis Stevens is a power puncher.
Yeah.
Look, he and nobody even staggers him. And all he did when he fought Lemieux was he just scared the shit out of the rest of the division by beating them with actual boxing skills. Like, oh, fuck that. So this guy could actually outbox me and knock me out?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we see Canelo like, well, you know, I don't know if I'm going to fight him next. Now, maybe afterwards, as far as Canelo goes with that bullshit with the 154, I'd have fought him at 154. What the fuck is, why would Khan even contemplate that thought? If I'm coming up, why am I not going to fight you at 155 and fight for the fucking title?
Common sense.
It was Canelo's way of using these guys all learn from each other. He learned. He used the Floyd tactic. Well, he asked for 155. I offered this. You know, it's like I asked for 150. He said 152, so he asked for 152, and it's the same thing that you know, Floyd said Oscar did to him. It's the same thing that Oscar said that the one before him did to it's a vicious cycle. And all it is excuses to make yourself look good. Look, I was the good guy. I was really trying. Then you should just find my 160.
I'm not on his side with this one. But I'll say he had the better alibi than anybody. So if you want to do this, Canelo, have the better alibi. You know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
He had the 47 and the 54 title at the time. So Canelo, if it's only 1 pound, get the 54 title. Which you shouldn't have never, you know what I'm saying? Get a 54 title and the 60 title. And then you can say whatever you want. Because you can say, look, I'm fighting him for the 60 title at 155 because he's really a 147. Then you could get yourself some wiggle.
And remember, he turned down the 54 title when he fought Laura.
Right.
He's like, I'm not paying the fee. I ain't even fighting for that title. So he took that excuse. It's just, you know what? It's just Canelo's way of trying to make himself look good in a shitty situation that he brought upon himself. And that shit ain't, I ain't falling for it.
And I don't want to get his back on this, but I got to. This is what happens when everybody in front of you does egregious shit when they have, you know, when they are the A side. Because he's doing the same shit Cotto did, ain't he?
Yeah.
He doing the same shit they got done to him with Floyd. He probably did the same shit to with the whole CISO.
He's done to a lot of people, so.
Yeah, like, it's like, you know, I know he did it to Angulo. But it's one of those situations where, come on, look. Fans will love you because, quote unquote, you're a star. But this is America, and let's be honest, once you become a star, then we hate your guts. If you was my favorite singer last year, but you had one too many hits, and now you sound terrible. I don't give a damn that this is the best song ever. You know, this is the problem. Because now it's like, I overlooked it a couple of times. You're hitting your threshold of overlooks. So, you know, but there's also what I mean by this may be the year to upset because you keep playing with fire, eventually you're going to get burned. You know, and truth be told, that I think that was I'm not going to use the name no more. I'm going to just use the acronym. That was the TBE scenario because everybody want all this craziness. You keep playing with fire, you got to get burned eventually. And that's one of the things I'm guessing people was like, got to see TBE lose because you doing the most right now. You the most aggravated person I've ever met. You getting the most trouble outside of this. You're doing the most. And I just got, something got to catch up with you. But it's happening to Canelo right now. And the question is to me, is it the pressure of getting called to the carpet for your BS going to catch up with you? Or is it just stardom in boxing or, you know, lack of discipline? Because getting back to the catchweight situation, the catchweight and the weights sometimes seem like a lack of discipline. Because 54 is 1 pound.
Yeah.
And if I'm not mistaken, what if he was 154 and 9 ounces? Doesn't that still count?
No, they got to. There's usually hard weights. I think it's the UFC. Some of them do the half pound thing where they have that wiggle room.
Right. So I mean, he could be almost close to halfway at 155 anyway. So it's not like he's got to lose a whole pound. And like people act like it's a whole, like you can't lose one whole pound, one. And then to say I'm gonna go back, I was gonna fight if it, dude, you can't do that.
No.
The reason why you can't do that is because you. Well, you can do that because Broner did the same thing. But that's the same reason why you can make it. I thought your young frame was too big for it. Mm-hmm. Now that you've grown out of it, you had to grow upward. Now you just grew 1 pound upward, and now you can't go the other four, but you can go back down one.
Yeah.
Maybe we shouldn't have went to school. Just maybe.
Get you in trouble.
But
learning how to think for yourself.
But I'm gonna say I'm gonna get us in trouble by saying this. Truth be told, WBC fault.
The WBC actually said if they came in at 160 that they were still going to sanction the fight. So I would call the bluff just to fuck it. I'm going to come in at 160. No, I'm doing 155, and then come in at 160. What you going to do now?
Because, you know, that was the situation with Cotto, right? And how did Cotto actually lose the belt? By not paying a fee, really.
Which one?
The fight with Canelo.
Remember, that's right.
He didn't even pay the fee before the fight. He didn't have a belt before the fight.
That's because he knew he was going to lose.
You know what I'm saying? So, look, I'm an A-side. I get paid. I don't have to do nothing, you know, and I get rid of this belt, and I ain't got to worry about the fee. That's a win, even in a lose, you know.
All right, man, let's cut it off there. I'm surprised we ain't got 50 minutes out of this, because there was shit. At least next week we got Warden Barrera's fighting. A closer fight than I think people think. Neeson may come on the show. He's supposedly going up to Oakland. I hope he's not buying a ticket. I hope he's getting a free one because I heard the ticket sales ain't shit. So you can get a real cheap one if he hasn't already bought his ticket.
Sit next to Beast Mode.
May sit next to Steph Curry.
No, don't do that.
So like we do.
I'm hating on Steph right now.
Follow us on Twitter, Chiefsies Box, iTunes, Stitcher, rate, review, and subscribe. Be the next unofficial sponsor. Take the time out to rate and review, and you know you will be recognized as the unofficial sponsor of the next episode. So go ahead and help us out. Keep us high up on them rankings when people search boxing on iTunes, like you guys have been doing. You can email the show, cheapseatsboxing@yahoo.com. You can go to Cafe Press, check out the merchandise if you guys want to help us out that way. Anything else, JP?
First, I don't want the Warriors to break the Bulls' records. That's why I'm hating. Now, this is where the fighters fight the fans commentate.
And I do, because fuck the Bulls and fuck Michael Jordan. And we do it just like you from the cheap seats, because I ain't buying no tickets, goddammit. Peace.